Hi everyone, welcome to the Entrepet podcast. This is me, Ekam, co-founder and your host for today's episode. Today we have with us Meenakshi and Bhavisha, founders of Capsule, which is India's first multi-brand streetwear store. In this episode, we explore the details of pioneering the streetwear movement in India, on being young female founders and the struggles and advice that comes with being an entrepreneur at such an early age. So stay tuned. Hi, Bhavisha and Meenakshi. Thank you so much for being here today. I'm so excited to have this conversation with you all today. So for our listeners, could you guys just take us through a bit of what Capsule is all about?
Hi, Ekum. Thanks for having us. I'm Meenakshi and Bhavisha is also sitting next to me. So really excited to be on your podcast. We have heard good things about Entrepret and
I guess
this is the beginning of a nice series with entrepreneurs, I guess.
Yeah.
So happy to be here.
Lovely. Thank you so much.
Capsule, as we say, is our love child. So basically, Bhavisha and I, both of us were in corporate jobs. We quit that and we started Capsule, which is India's first and currently the only streetwear retail platform.
Right.
By that, we mean that we are the first people who brought down original streetwear brands to India.
Yeah.
We have currently around 18 brands on the website, a couple of other ones in the pipeline that we want to launch. But pandemic happened, so I guess 2021 we'll see a few more new brands from our side.
Right. That's amazing. But you know, I've already seen like that you guys house a lot of international brands that are hard to find in India. And personally, I've shopped from there as well, so I love the collection. And but you know, how did you guys actually come to think about streetwear, or you know, just starting like a multi-brand retail store? Like, how did that idea like come to you all? Like, were you guys mentioned that you guys were working and you know, you wanted to sort of you know, change what you were doing. So could both of you take us through your background, like what inspired you and like what was that moment when you decided, okay, you know, we want to really launch Capsule and this is it. Like, what was that journey like for you?
So I was actually going to let Meenakshi answer this, but she's been like nudging away at me simply because we told you we will be very proper on this podcast.
No,
so I've just been sort of like, I've had like almost like my arms been boxed at so much. So I'm stepping in. But you know, both Meenakshi and I worked at Puma. Since I think 2011, we've been working together, both first in India and then we went on, you know, to work in international offices.
Yeah.
And even while we were working internationally, so while we were in India, we ended up working a lot together. And the way we operated, Puma was a challenger brand at the time.
Right.
And our entire way was of sort of using, you know, the ethos of street culture and the ethos of young, cool challenger brands. That's how we built our entire marketing communication and strategies.
Right.
And we believe that that led to Puma taking the number one spot by 2014 in India.
Right.
So in a sense, we always worked with the elements of street culture, of youth culture. Completely in the marketing of Puma, and that's how essentially those are things that both Meenakshi and I really love. You know, in fact, even while growing up, I've grown up on a very heavy dose of skating. I used to skate. I wasn't a skateboarder, I was a speed skater.
Right.
In fact, one of my best national championships was in Patiala.
Oh,
so a healthy dose of the X Games and of course basketball and hip hop, you know.
Right.
Meenakshi had her influences. So
You grew up with these influences. Like they were always like, you know, around you and you were always like really interested in everything. And that's what sort of led you to, you know.
Yeah, it's kind of like, you know, that's what I reminisce right now, that it's all of that stuff which I loved.
Yeah.
And now it's come around to allow me to build a career out of it. And to a very, very large extent, I would even say that even in Puma India and even internationally, we were using these elements as part of the marketing strategy, essentially who we were. And fast forward to when we went outside of India. And that's when, for me personally, I used to work out of Turkey and Russia, so Istanbul and Moscow. And these are exceptionally like fun markets, Moscow especially. I credit that with influencing me, you know, in that period of my life extensively.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when I realized that all of this cool stuff, actually there's a proper business to it, and there are enough number of people employed in this business having a great time doing cool, fun things, curating great experiencing, building great product, building phenomenal platforms, really creating innovative marketing and communication strategies and stuff like that. And essentially there was sort of like a you know, like a cool kids uniform, if you will, or kind of brands that are worn by culture leaders, opinion leaders, taste makers. And these were streetwear brands, right? These were some of the streetwear brands. Even brands like Puma, Nike, Adidas were collaborating a lot at that time. You know, there was a shift happening at a global level between, you know, performance in terms of like running and like performance sports to a more lifestyle, you know, where sport is a way of life or life is a sport, that sort of a thing. And, you know, so we knew of these brands, obviously, because we were with Puma.
Athleisure actually came into being.
Athleisure became a big force, you know, with Lululemon and everything. And simultaneously, while we were outside, we were obviously connected with people from India, right? And we saw that there were takers for these brands, you know, these streetwear brands. 2010 to 2020 was a decade for streetwear as well. And we were pleasantly surprised to see that there are people, the way they were hustling, you know, to cop stuff. And one day when we were back in India for a holiday over, for me, it was a deconstructed Moscow mule. For Meenakshi, it was Steve. We decided to sort of like explore doing this together.
Right.
And we came back to Star Capsule because we saw this opportunity, you know, for to bring these brands to India and make them available at retail and to curate like this whole space, which is all about like community experiences. You know, it's more a vibe, it's more a lifestyle, it's more
like
a culture, and product comes secondary.
Absolutely. I mean, as many people as I've spoken to who've been in streetwear, who collect like sneakers, it's like a massive lifestyle for them. It's a way to live, you know. It's not just like a trend or like, you know, a new fad. It's something that they actually believe in, like, you know, from the core of their hearts. So I can totally believe that when you say that, you know, it's something much more exceptional than just, you know, a subculture.
Yeah.
So yeah.
I think overall for us, Capsule happened because of the years that we spent growing up to a certain aspirational lifestyle.
Right.
Then our experience mixed with it, you know, with working with Puma. And then over these years and with, you know, while traveling other countries and exploring culture, food, people, and places, I guess we developed a certain sense of aesthetics. Mm-hmm. And that's all, you know, mixed in a hot mug of coffee, I guess. That's what Capsule is.
That's amazing. Yeah. So when exactly did you guys start? Like you mentioned that from 2010 to 2020 was like, you know, the era of streetwear. Like when exactly did you guys like, you know, put this idea into action? When did that start?
So we both moved back to India, I think in 2018. And we spent almost like all of 2018 and the early couple of months of 2019 to build our connections to get these brands into the country, you know, which meant, you know, creating a whole vision for our vision for what we saw for streetwear in India, sharing that with the brands, getting their buy-in, you know, getting a good assortment of products. So we had our website as a trial thing from June of 2018. And before that, in March of 2018, you know, there was this event happening called 8G Street.
Right.
In March in Delhi.
Okay.
And we figured that that was the best time to test the idea for Capsule. Right. So because of our sort of like, you know, our experience of working in Europe, and we have friends over there who own stores, we were able to get a bunch of product, you know, an entire assortment, different brands, different products, and we were going to test the market. Now, that's when we found out it's super challenging to just bring in products into the country, even though we have our import-export code and everything. Mm-hmm. You know, the customs can be a real
pain
in the ass. So we're like, you know, screw it, we're going to fly to Germany, pick up the product in our suitcases.
Oh, that's amazing.
And then bring it all to India. So we managed that. We were scared we were going to be overweight and everything. And, you know, I get my bags at Bangalore airport. And I'm thrilled. I'm walking up to Meenakshi. And then she's like gesturing madly. She's like, don't come near me. You know, she's telling me, don't come near me. Then she calls me, just take a U-turn and, you know, get out of the airport. Apparently her bag was, you know, X-marked and stuff like that.
No way.
Like a ton of product in it, right? But obviously nothing happened because it was in electronics and all, so they just sort of like just scanned it and then they let her go, and next thing I see Meenakshi's with me. It was our first brush with the challenges of Indian customs.
Right. Right.
Anyway, we go to AG Street and we thought maybe, you know, no, so we didn't expect anybody to know about these brands.
Hmm.
I don't think too many people did, but there's a certain energy around these brands and around the booth and the entire event, right? People are curious to know. We thought we'd sell like 5, 10, 15 units, 15 pieces, 15 t-shirts. Right. Right. We were almost sold out.
Wow.
And we could have done more sales, but we didn't have enough of a size set.
Right. Right.
So we're like, okay, cool. Now this is a good step one, good piloting. And then we set about getting everything in order, right? From how to bring the products into the country, customs mm-hmm. and, you know, properly and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
And by 2019 March, our website actually had about 7 or 8 brands with enough styles, like, you know, some sort of like a minimum offering to the consumer, not just 2 brands, 3 styles, like, you know, something to at least choose from.
Of course.
Because these are not brands that people are going to say, oh no, I'll buy anything by the hundreds. Like, they also want some sort of an assortment.
Of course. Everybody wants, like, you know, options. I'm just giving like 3 things and I expect them to be like happy. But that's amazing.
Yeah, that's so 2000 March. So we kind of came about in 2019, in March of 2019.
So you guys are relatively just 1 year old. That's amazing. I mean, I honestly, I would have assumed it's been like at least 4 or 5 years that you guys have actually established.
No, I guess 16 or 17 months.
Insane. That's amazing. Like, kudos to you guys. Like, you know, in just 1 year, you guys have managed to build like quite a massive presence on social media and otherwise. You know,
thank you so much. That it just feels so great and sort of like it really feels great and humbling to hear that.
I mean, testament to the fact that there's a massive streetwear market in India, a massive one. You know,
yeah.
In 1 year, you guys were able to be, to see so much like presence and like so much traction. It just, you know, goes to say that there's a massive gap that people are actually looking for. You know, people really want to wear streetwear, they just want sneakers. And I know at least 10 people who are like such huge fans of just like the Yeezys, or, you know, they wait for the next drop and they're like, you know, trading sneakers. So it's absolutely mm-hmm. like a very, very raging sensation right now, you know.
Sneaker market is a lot more developed in terms of more people are sort of more people understand spending that kind of money on, you know, on shoes. Usually like a price, like an average selling price for a shoe, before like the sort of the influx of this entire exciting sneaker culture, I think it would have been 3,500-4,000 an average selling price.
Right.
That's
how much a Nike sneaker costs. Like, it's about like 5,000, 4,000, 5,000. Like a nice
entry level. Exactly. You know, you get, that's a good price point for like Vans. You get good Fila's in there. There's good Pumas in there. Reebok classics, you know.
Right.
But it's the Yeezys, the Jordans, all the collab pieces that cost a lot more. A lot more people are, open to making those big ticket purchases.
Right.
And now we're waiting for, streetwear to sort of like catch up with that frenzy. Because if you've got great kicks, you need to have great fits.
Absolutely.
And that's where we've seen that people are not that experimental.
Right.
You know, so where, but even that's changing, you know, like we're seeing that more people are, experimenting with oversized silhouettes, with jackets, socks, colors.
Right. Even
pants. So it's, it's exciting times ahead.
Yeah. Even on that note, you know, there are so many new Indian streetwear brands that have come to life in the past 2 to 3 years. Like, what's your like take on that? Do you have any favorite brands? Do you think somebody, do you have or like know somebody or like, you know, buy from a certain brand that's doing some amazing work? Because we also did feature a few brands on Entrepreneur as well. But what's your take on these like newer, younger entrepreneurs who are getting into streetwear in India?
So we at Capsule totally believe in the indie scene as well. You know, in fact, we have a property called Word on the Street, which is basically an even sort of property which we take to various cities every once in a quarter, minus the pandemic. But that is one platform which, you know, quite a few designers have, in a way, used to launch their stuff as well. We always invite and the labels that we believe might have a great future to participate at those events.
Right.
So we really believe in the indie scene. We feel that there are so many labels which are coming up every month, you know, now. I mean, it's the scene for India, I would say India's youth, to kind of flex their creativity. Sure. And there's a lot of scope. So if you look at the young designers who've been there for quite a few years, for example, Human,
right?
You know, they've always, from the beginning, they have their work was always about street lux when street lux was not a thing in India.
Right.
That kind of paved way for many young designers to come and, you know, showcase their work in a similar light.
Right.
One also came to be quite a few years back. And all of these guys who were there, you know, they're kind of the OGs of the Indian scene. They're now getting more and more recognition now that their category is so getting so popular in India.
Yeah.
Walking, he is doing so well, and his work is also, you know, of that international class.
So Jaywalking actually launched his brand at Our Word on the Street in April of last year in Bangalore.
Wow.
So Space Biscuit, Biscuit is another brand that we really love.
Many other brands are coming up. There's another brand launched by this guy called Kev from Calicut. He launched it yesterday or day before. The brand's called Encentive. E-N-C-N-T-V-E. Something like that. I'm not sure of the spelling, but like really great styling, products on point,
right.
Pricing is great for the Indian market.
Right.
So, you know, I mean, there are a lot of labels coming up, but people need to understand what streetwear is and then start calling their label streetwear, you know.
Correct.
It's not a sticker that you should slap on everything that you're making. So that's one thing that we would like to tell people, because we get approached by multiple people, many labels every day.
Right. I'm sure.
Yeah. And it's tough to, you know, kind of tell them what's wrong there, because it's rude, and it's we don't want to kind of underestimate or, you know, judge on anybody's potential.
Right.
But from our perspective, when we are kind of we have streamlined our business to streetwear and lifestyle, right? Like streetwear is not only about certain products, it's about culture all around it. So like the people and the Indian labels which are coming up to kind of also think deeply when they're launching something.
Right.
And, just don't slap the sticker of streetwear on everything that is getting made.
That's important, I think.
Because that might not be the right thing to do.
I think just to do it, just to call yourself like a streetwear brand is probably just like not cool. You should probably just understand, you know, what exactly your product offering is and like what consumer base are actually like capturing. So I think that's a really important point that people do need to understand right now. Absolutely. And you know, funnily enough, I've actually seen two people in the last 2 days launch sneaker marketplaces. Literally two people in the last 2 days. So that's how much, you know, that's how popular it's becoming, you know, recently. And
because I mean, what we know, there are more than 600-700 resellers in the country right now.
Insane.
The market is really huge, and we are glad that streetwear is taking to it. Like, I mean, we also get a advantage by a piece of the pie at the end of the day, because people buy from us and flip it somewhere else, which is not our ultimate goal, because our curation is all about basically bringing that equity to the market, you know. Brands, we are friends of the brands.
Mm-hmm.
And we want to curate best of the stuff that those brands would like to see in the right hands or on the right people, in a way. Not discounting, I mean, you know, not looking, sorry, what do I say? Like, basically, I don't want to, I'm not trying to say anything wrong about the people who cannot
afford
or like style streetwear.
Hmm.
But it's how brands also think, and they want their products to be seen on people who can actually
walk the talk.
Exactly.
It has nothing to do with price points. It's
about
a certain authenticity. You know?
Exactly.
It's about sort of like finding your tribe and calling out to it through the way you dress, I guess.
Yeah.
Of course.
And coming back to the marketplace, I guess it only elevates, I would say, the equity of the product, as well as it also kind of increases the longevity of the product, because you know, a lot of products also go into that whole vintage section if they're old and then they're resold. And that whole cycle of fashion is extended, which is really good for not only for social impact, but also for the environment.
Right. That's amazing, guys. I think that's some cool stuff happening in India, honestly, and I love it. I mean, I personally haven't been a huge fan of streetwear, but honestly, the more that I get into it, I love it.
It's very interesting. Like, what is streetwear today?
Right.
It's actually lifestyle, you know. It's the millennials and Gen Z. They have a way they prefer to dress, right? Like, it has to be casual clothing. And streetwear, the way, like, what I love, what the way I see it, it's like the power dressing in the casual wear world, in the casual world.
Right.
You know.
Right.
And even a lot of like the OG streetwear brands, they are moving away from the tag of streetwear because they're like, we're a lifestyle brand, you know, because streetwear has a certain, comes with heavy baggage.
For sure.
2010 to 2020 was when a lot of luxury brands flirted, collaborated, in bed with a lot of streetwear brands. So streetwear brands effectively influenced, you know, luxury brands, which is why you have, you know, Gucci, Balenciaga sneakers, t-shirts, track pants and stuff like that. What we're super excited to see is this decade where it's going to be the reverse effect. So, you know, you have like luxury and tailoring affecting brands that have a streetwear ethos, you know, giving rise to luxury streetwear, street luxe. So brands like a Cold Wall, Daily Paper, Les Benjamin, all of these, you know, it's super exciting, the kind of stuff that they're doing. So, and even like your heritage luxury brands, you know, even there, like the osmosis is sort of complete. So streetwear is not a trend. It's not a category. It's a certain ethos, and it's influenced, you know, brands across the board.
Right.
Because customers are essentially, the largest chunk is the youth.
Correct.
In fact, there is a study by Bain which says that by 2025, 61% of the luxury purchases will be done by millennials and Gen Z.
That's amazing.
Youth, you know. So that has already happened, and now there's going to be, like, you know, you're seeing the effect of streetwear, the effect of youth fashion, even in like tailored clothing, and it's really exciting. And overall, the whole idea that, you know, what Meenakshi also touched upon is, for us, we, you know, for us, streetwear is basically like synonymous with lifestyle, and it's like, I love to say this because this is my personal belief. It's like, it allows you to participate in slow fashion. You know, it's not about what you wear and what the latest trend is, because what you cop or what you're wearing was cool 5 years ago. It's cool now. It will be cool even 5 years later. You know, it doesn't follow trends. It's timeless in that sense. If there's a cool collaboration between, let's say, the Hundreds and Blue the Great, that t-shirt is going to be cool no matter what, you know? And the idea is to buy less, but buy well. Also, if you spend a little bit more on your product, you're going to take a lot more care of it. You're not just going to like wear and throw. You're going to, you know, take better care of it and hopefully allow it to become into a vintage piece, which you never know may just even give you, at some point in time, you know, it may just give you a premium.
You know, Bhavisha, that's amazing that you actually touched upon that and actually, you know, explained all that, because that was one of my biggest questions to you. You know, do you think it's a fad or a trend? And you answered that so beautifully, you know, it's definitely not, you know.
It's not a fad at all. I mean, you know, even though streetwear, as what Bhavisha said, that a lot of streetwear brands, they don't want to be labeled as streetwear only, but they're all about lifestyle.
Right.
It's not a fad at all, because that whole lifestyle will continue. Streetwear as a culture will keep on differentiating itself from the streetwear product side of it, you know?
It is diversified.
It will always live on. And the product might have another label. It could go sartorial, but it'll come back to being streetwear again in a couple of years. So that is how it will be.
That's amazing. And that's actually so interesting to also maybe like read about or actually understand, because it's something so dynamic, right? In fashion, everything's always changing. So you're always wondering if this is going to be a fad or trend which is going to go tomorrow, you know? But that's amazing.
Aspect to it, you know, that we've come across a couple of times. People are sort of intimidated sometimes by streetwear. You know, they're like, I don't understand this. This is not my cup of thing. We're like, you know, it's just so strange, because if I know who you are as a person who we're talking, like, streetwear is about self-expression. It's about wearing comfortable clothes. It's about, you know, sort of not just chasing like fast fashion trends and stuff like that. So anybody who does that kind of a a dressing, even if it's a mashup and stuff like that. Because, you know, streetwear takes a lot of cues. Today, if you see, they take a lot of cues from different cultures.
So,
people, for instance, right? Every drop of theirs focuses on some culture from a country in Africa. Le Benjamin, over all the different seasons, they have covered so many different cultures. It's a Turkish brand. They've done one entire drop focusing on a certain tribe from Mongolia. You know, they've done one drop on something else. So it's a beautiful way to showcase culture through through product. And there's a lot of people who, without even realizing that they're into streetwear, they're into streetwear. Because it's not just about the brands that are commonly considered streetwear and stuff like that. You know, it's not only about the hype. There's different kinds of people experimenting and participating in the whole, you know, movement in their own way.
Right.
You know, as there's one a quarterly report of Hype Snob ID that came out today, and it has a beautiful line saying that hype will die out. You know, it lives only when the customer pays attention, but curation lives forever. I guess that's how streetwear has lived forever, because the brands that we have, for example, we have Hundreds, which is an 18-year-old brand. Stussy started in 1980. Carhartt that we have is over 100 years old. So it's not like that they were born yesterday.
Correct. And they've been here for a while, yes. And
it's just that this whole fashion and youth culture today, what it is making it more and more popular.
That's amazing. That's actually so interesting to actually just hear about also from you guys. You know, of course, you guys know so much. That's amazing, guys. You know, I think next something else that I want to touch upon is maybe, you know, streetwear influences in India. Do you guys have anybody who, you know, you guys like look up to, maybe like somebody like Anand Ahuja or somebody else who's doing like something really interesting? Is there somebody that you think is, you know, one of the top thought leaders in streetwear in India?
I guess streetwear as a concept in India is so new that personally, I don't see that there are stalwarts there who we do look up to.
Right.
But like, I personally find my inspiration, or, you know, I really like watching the feed of people who are around me. For example, our colleague Haya Hamza, I really like watching how she kind of styles herself every day, and the stories that she tells about every product that she has. Gokul from Bangalore, you know. His lifestyle around streetwear, his bikes and his stories about his sneakers. Vedu Lamba from Bombay, you know, the stories that he has about each pair that he has copped or gotten for somebody.
Actually, just a podcast.
A lot of people in and around us, BioBlad is Uday Shankar, who is in Delhi right now, you know.
Manpreet Arjun,
Aman Parmar. They have great stories. Like, if you sit with Aman Parmar, he's like a storybook, you know. So these are the people who I personally draw inspiration from. Alan, for example, and Claudius from Bombay.
Okay, I have no idea.
He's been at it for years. So I mean, I would say these are the people who we really, you know, like how they curate their own wardrobes,
right?
And it's not based on what the product, you know, product's color is, or what the trend is,
or what the logo is. You know, it's not just the product or the fit. You know, there's much larger stories around it. You know, they're interesting. Like, for me, like, if I learn something new from their stories, that for me is time well spent. You know, like something interesting, something new that I didn't know earlier. There's this other couple of other names. Is, I don't know if I'm saying it right, Erim Singh. Her content is super interesting, as is Kritika. What's her name? Mermaid Scales. Why I'm mentioning her name, but it's, I have seen, like, for me, like, first of all, her fits are great, but the amount of trouble and effort she goes through, you know, she takes to sort of create all that content with cosplay, with costumes and stuff like that is next level.
It's
you know, the content may be sort of like stuff for it's stuff for easy consumption, but the stylized videos and the styling behind it is what I really appreciate.
I think quite a few people who are building their personality around sneakers and streetwear, and it's great to see. Like, example would be Shivani Borua, how her whole feed right now, you know, it has got one sneaker and streetwear aesthetic.
Right.
And it just building this whole culture behemoth now, you know,
culture,
like,
yeah, absolutely.
Unstoppable. People have literally tasted the blood, and streetwear and the street culture is just going places.
Absolutely, dude. Like, I feel like we ourselves, like, in the past 3 months have interviewed and spoken to like 3 people who are into streetwear, you know, and like, this is like a second podcast. We also did a podcast with Vedu Lamba, and it was amazing as well. Like, his interview was like great as well, you know. So just to see that passion and just to see that kind of energy that everybody puts into this kind of culture, it's actually very different. It's very new, and it's very fresh, you know, and you can actually tell that, you know, somebody's into streetwear, or they're, you know, like, they're passionate about something as interesting as, like, you know.
Yeah, it's also changing the perspective of consumers or appreciators towards what is being made, you know, like the products being made in small batches, the DIY stuff, the not so cheap stuff, you know, like, it always costs someone to make something which is done in small batches and which is highly curated. So I guess now even the youth will try and understand, or they're already now kind of understanding, why does a designer dress, or why does a particular artist t-shirt cost so much, you know?
Right. I think people have like a very good, especially like the younger generation, Gen Zers, I think they're just so aware and educated of what's happening that they actually understand the difference between fast fashion and something as
100%. That's what we've seen. It's really, really, and then also demanding a lot more sort of social consciousness from brands. Yeah. Demanding conversations, and it's great to see.
Yeah, you know, and by the virtue of what we curate, our products are already at a certain price point. And we know that there are a lot of youth who are not able to afford that, but quite a few people who speak to us one-on-one, you know, they have been able to kind of crack some EMI deals with us. We know these students that they badly want that particular t-shirt or that basketball. And if we know them personally, then we kind of make that available to them. We know that it's very aspirational for those people.
Right.
And we don't want to take that element of happiness away from them. So
that's so sweet, you guys. And, you
know, yeah, we don't want the price point to be a hindrance in what somebody wants to own, because it's not like the old time galleries, right? Like, today's youth culture is in a way quite inclusive. And that's one of the reasons why we were attracted to streetwear so much. Because it's just that streetwear and the street culture kind of opens
community, right? Yeah. It's like a really,
like,
inviting community. It's somebody who, like, people who want you to be a part of, you know, something much bigger than themselves. You know,
And clothes and sneakers come secondary. You know, it's just and come secondary.
That's amazing, guys. That's some really great, like, insights into the sneaker world and streetwear. And, you know, I also want to sort of understand your business and both of you from a entrepreneurial, you know, point of view. So if you could just, you know, take us through, I know we've touched upon this in the beginning, but just going back to that a little bit, while you guys were launching this business in the beginning, what were like some of the setbacks that you faced, or, you know, being like a women-led brand, both of you are like, you know, so strong-headed and, you know, like smashing it in life right now. But were there any like roadblocks that you guys faced in the Indian market when you guys started out? Like, how did that go for you guys?
Well, it's not been so tough, but it's also not been so easy. From the beginning, you know, just the import-export deal of any business is very, very tough. So we are retailers. And for retail, we have to set our products at a certain MRP, which also includes the GST. And we have to kind of account for all the custom duties and other logistics fee that we pay.
Right.
And as an entrepreneur, we off street where we can only tell you that there might not be margins to be made when you're looking at lower volumes, which is what you can actually afford when you're bootstrapped like us. So it's a longer game that we have invested ourselves in. You have to have that vision, you know, what do you want to do? We basically want to create that concept store which kind of welcomes everyone and offers a great, you know, folio of products and experiences. So definitely, like, customs is one of the biggest hindrances when you're importing stuff, because you'll have to have all sorts of certificates for your own company. You have to be a private limited, and you'll have to gather all sorts of certificates. Then you also have to gather certificates of, say, what a particular product is made of, you know. And the streetwear brands might not have those products. So you have to kind of work around it. Like, either you invest in getting those certificates done, or you basically work with the customs to kind of bring those products in the right way. You know, a lot of products like sneaker cleaning, we have a section of shoe care products, the sneaker cleaning kits and deodorizers and repel sprays and all of that. They are considered to be chemically hazardous. So in the beginning, that was a big.
But they are not.
They're not. It's like so it's just what customs have, you know, set kind of parameters about. It's not hazardous, but it's just what they have in their books. Right. So again, like we'll have
which is a function of a certain HS code, that's a harmonized code. That is about it.
So that about customs, but. Overall, I mean, we being two women, it gives us power together to kind of wade through all the challenges. But streetwear globally is a male-dominated industry.
Right.
We have actually faced, I would say, yeses and nos because we are female. Mm-hmm. I would say a mix of that.
Right.
You know, we had a call with a very interesting brand from Amsterdam. And the first thing that he said was, oh, I was expecting Mr. Singh and Mr. Dave on the call.
Oh, wow.
So, yeah, you know, like, but people, I don't know, we haven't faced really,
I think
bad experiences, but there are understated, I would say.
Subtleties, yeah. Which you also like realize.
That you don't, we don't talk about, but, but yeah, there are these hindrances, but I think we always see the positive and we kind of, we always get on the task to kind of overcome that hindrance, you know, together.
Right.
So we have bypassed those.
Both of you have each other, and I think that's also something.
Thankfully, I would also like to say it's the fact that there's both of us in this together, right?
Right, that's exactly what I was saying.
Each other's support system, and thankfully, so if I'm on a high, Meenakshi's on a low, and vice versa, right? So we can always keep each other grounded.
Right.
Or sort of, you know, support each other. So I guess. And of course, you know, our family, our friends, we have a phenomenal support system, and a lot of them would be
amazing
outside of the quote unquote streetwear community as it's understood as a streetwear community. You know, so it helps to have a lot more things going on outside, so you're not too bothered. We just don't let anything, even if there is something which may be sort of perceived as, oh, because we're women, this is what's happening. We don't let it bother us or even get to us. And that's just something we throw out of our heads, you know?
That's amazing. I think you need to have thick skin, whether you're a man or a woman at some point, you know?
You have a thick skin, especially in this industry when you're trying to do something, because everybody's going to be standing on the sidelines and watching you. And my God, there are so many haters around.
And especially in entrepreneurship, and when you're this young, I feel younger people get more like, you know, I mean, they're doubted more because, you know,
social media has allowed people to just say whatever comes to their mind without any filter, right? And there's invariably a lot more hate.
Cancel culture. Yeah.
Exactly. Exactly. And that is something that I read a couple of months ago, High Sobriety again, you know, has been doing these phenomenal insight reports, quarterly insight reports. Like, we really recommend reading those because it's, while it is streetwear and sneakers and fashion and everything, just their editorial team has been doing amazing pieces. So in that, it actually spoke about, you know, how we need to stop getting involved in cancel culture and start holding people accountable. So if you have something to say, work towards improving it. But cancel culture doesn't help anybody.
Of course, definitely. It's done so much harm, like, you know, over the past, like, 2-3 years. And some people have just suddenly, like, gone all out and just hating people instead of actually just fixing or talking it out or actually, you know, having a conversation about it. And that's become a norm now, which I think people need to really, really start, you know, being more aware about. You know,
on the lighter side, when we started our website and we integrated our chat feature and all, so overall we have two types of shoppers. One set is from the community who know us directly. So they know, like, they might not go through the official chat system, but they might, like, just message us one-on-one. The other segment is the larger audience who shop from us. They are not part of the core community, and they're like maybe the first time shoppers or people who have just gotten to know about us. But also, like, you know, just generally a lot of kids who hit us up for various products. They would always call us bro, bruh, and all of that, you know. So now we have a couple of bros on our intern roles who are handling those chats. But yeah, we were the bros initially kind of chatting with the people, because they just don't imagine a lady sitting at the other end and talking about sneakers or streetwear and just the styling part of it. And not only that, not just styling, but like generally like history of
the product. Remember that one phone call that came like once on the capsule number, and this guy calls, he's like, he was stunned that I answered, right? He's like, hello? Aap madam ho? Hello? Aap madam? I'm like, how can I help you? But he was stunned. Like he was speechless. It wasn't a dude at the other end.
Right. Oh, really?
Yeah. I mean, that's what Meenakshi's saying, that everyone expects whoever they're talking to at Capsule to be a dude.
Yeah. 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 So you guys have also like smashed that glass ceiling as well, just to be like,
we let them think whatever they want to think. It doesn't bother us.
That's amazing, guys. That's
if they want us to be bros, we can.
Yeah. Right. But you're still a bro, right?
I mean, we're still a bro. But, yeah.
Yeah, for sure. Okay, guys. So just moving on to our last segment of the podcast. Do you guys have any advice to give young entrepreneurs like yourself, or somebody who people who love sneakers, people who really want to get into the streetwear business? What is your advice to them from like maybe, you know, having starting something on your own, which is like a clothing label or something, or just, you know, getting into the curation business or getting into the marketplace business? Like, what would your advice be to these people?
Whatever you want to do, just try it out. You know, as long as you know why you're doing it and you have a genuine reason, and it's not just, oh, because this is cool, or this will get me money, or this is the coolest trend right now, I need to be part of it. Like, as long, like, the story needs to be there, and try it. You know, there's no harm in you know, the learning will be immense when you try something. You know, don't be scared, just try it out. And like, even if you fail, that's like the best teacher. And as cliched as that sounds, you know, I've always said that, you know, you learn when things go right. You don't really, you just, okay, cool, it went okay, but only when things go wrong is when you try and figure it out and you know better.
Right.
You shouldn't be scared.
Opposite.
Yeah, I know. You should, like, yeah, and you know, yeah, I think, and that's why it works so well, right? Like, you should never be scared of trying anything. And, you know, you can, like, plan, you can do whatever and spend time, but nothing for me beats jumping into the field, you know, rolling up your sleeves and trying out stuff.
Yeah.
I would say, I just have a slightly opposite, I would say, idea to add to this. Yes, don't be scared to jump into anything and try that, but there's always a set process. In today's world, nothing is unique. Those processes and that research can be found if you, you know, kind of dwell a bit deeper via internet or while, you know, like by talking to people.
Yeah.
So I guess just follow a bit of process as well while you're at it, you know. I guess it'll just help save your energy and your finances and a lot more harassment.
So I'm guessing you're the safe one in the partnership.
exactly what I was going to say. That all find a co-founder who's your exact complement and whom you have massive amounts of respect for. So now Meenakshi and I have been through a decade of, you know, understanding how each other functions, and there's just nothing but respect. So yeah, there. And this is what you're hearing on the podcast. Just one of many examples where we have diametrically opposite approaches to a problem. But then, you know, it allows us to come to a mid-ground, which is a lot more well-thought out.
I was just going to say that, because the things that you probably don't think about, she does, right? And that's what's amazing. Like, she's filling in the gaps for you, or like, you know, vice versa. I think that's a great partnership. And the fact that you guys can come to a conclusion while having different opinions, that says so much about just being, you know, logical in the business you're running, which is so important, right?
It makes the process that much more fun, you know?
Right. That's amazing, yeah. And
having a partner in a company, be that a co-founder or somebody who you can trust on, and if you can vibe on food and drinks, nothing like it. that makes for it.
I personally agree with you on that, absolutely.
So, you know, for example, if we're traveling, you know, usually itineraries are always like in and around like cool concept stores.
Yeah.
So I have to plan the store route, and Meenakshi has to plan all the food pit stops.
Oh, that's
amazing. And she'll find these gems. Like in Mexico, she found this, what used to be some old church, which has been converted into this beautiful breakfast, beautiful, like gorgeous, where the nuns themselves prepare the food and the children die for.
That's incredible, dude. Please, like, send me the address of this location. Like, I'd love to go visit it for sure. that's amazing, you guys. That's really inspiring as well. And you know, one more question we always get is it worth spending on maybe like an MBA or a business degree? Like education is always something that, you know, people always ask us about, you know, they want to learn from on entrepreneur. It's always about like, do I do something in reality? Like, okay, I'm right out of college. I've worked for a few years. Do I just go ahead and start my own business, or do I like do like a master's in something, or do I do an MBA, or do I do something in business? So do you guys have any experience with that, or do you have any advice for people who always, you know, are on the lookout for this kind of information?
Well, personally, I don't think there's a right or a wrong here. Both of us have our degrees from reputed colleges. I'm a design graduate from NIFT. Bhavisha has an MBA from AIIM.
Lovely. Right.
You know, it just gave us another edge, I would say, because then we kind of got opportunity to work with a company like Puma in India and internationally. And then we are doing what we're doing right now. But we have seen multiple people who haven't, you know, who have dropped out of college and they're just
doing a great job
at what they're doing, and they're just doing so well. So I don't think there's a right or wrong, but you need to know that what you're stepping in is are the right pair of shoes, I guess.
Right. Be more aware of what you want to achieve, or like, you know, what you're investing in. Maybe even with an investment point of view, people talk about, okay, what's my ROI if I'm spending like, say, X amount of money going to this college? You know, that also comes up with a lot of people. So maybe like, you know, just find a balance between what you want to do in the future. And maybe
a lot of people expect that, you know, your school or your education path will help you get to the right answer. And the thing is that you need to figure that out for yourself. And I don't think Meenakshi said it perfectly. I think it's about figuring out what kind of person you are. There are some people who we also know now across different age groups who learn on their own. You know, it's like they learn piecemeal. Like if they want to learn something particular, they'll check a YouTube video and stuff like that. Now, if that's your learning style, cool. Someone like me, I need a process when it comes to learning. So for me, I cannot stress how amazing my MBA was for me. And it's not at all about, you know, what you study. It's about learning to deal with massive, like high pressure situations, with learning how to articulate yourself, with learning how to network, with learning how to get shit faced all night and still wake up in 3 hours and go give an exam.
That's a skill that you need to learn, actually.
Yeah. I guess so, there might be a difference, you know, in the two schools where people have actually gone to colleges and have acquired their degrees and then worked at various corporates. They might be able to work in multiple environments because the kind of situations that they've already faced. Right. While people who have just gotten at what they're doing might be experts at what they're doing currently, but I'm not sure if they'll be able to handle other situation also as smoothly as people who have taken, you know, proper education from universities.
Right.
I might be wrong at that, but this is just a thought.
I think that's a really,
good opinion. I mean,
I think a lot of people don't spend time to figure out what they really want, you know. Sabko matlab, they want to become, like, when we were young, it was engineer, MBA, IIM, lawyer, doctor. There are a lot more things people are getting into now, but it's you need to figure out for yourself.
I guess the gig economy doesn't need education. Gig economy might need mentors. But yeah, if you're in a traditional route of occupation, then definitely colleges and universities are the
one. For sure. I think that's some great advice, guys. Just to the last, you know, last question of the podcast. You know, like I personally also know that entrepreneurship is really hard, right? It's like you're doing everything at some point. You're stressed, you're broke. How have you guys sort of, you know, dealt with all these issues in the past, like 1 or 2 years since the time you've sort of, you know, just given birth to this idea? How does everyday motivation work for you guys? Because, you know, doing something at this scale requires a lot of like resilience and hard work, right? So how have you guys sort of traversed this phase of entrepreneurship, and what's your advice to people?
I mean, three things are really important in our lives: food, good wine, and massages. There have been phases.
That's the best answer I've got in my life.
You know, there have been phases where we were like tight with money, and we kind of really we re-strategized, rethought on the things that we kind of had to curtail and things that we had to actually spend on.
Right.
Those are usual things which I guess every business person has to go through, and they see that phase through. Apart from that, I guess
just keeping our heads down, working at our vision and aim that we, you know, have. And that has brought us where we are right now. It's still a journey for us. It's not like we are too new in the industry doing something on our own, with our own money. So, and we are too small right now. We have to, the scope of the growth and just like, you know, what we are looking at becoming later in a couple of years. There's so much to do.
That's amazing. That I think that's some really like honest, genuine advice. And also I feel like since you guys love what you do, it also adds to the whole motivational thing. I feel like people, I mean, that love or, you know, just general passion to do something is really important. Like it's cliche, but it's important, right? To just like...
Yeah, sure. I mean, you know, our friend, we have a lot of common friends. And whenever we sit with them for a, like a, just like a casual session, I think they get irritated because invariably we kind of start speaking about work. They might enjoy.
Trust me, I know what you're talking about.
But that is not the scene.
That's amazing, guys. I think you guys have given us some amazing, amazing content to learn from, to, you know, just ponder upon, some amazing insights about streetwear in India. And I'm so glad I did this with you guys. I learned so much today during this 1 hour. So thank you so much, you guys. And so grateful we could do this. And thank you for being so open to all our collaborations. Even Entrepret, like, we're so new. And we're also struggling right now. So it's really great to get this kind of response and love from brands that we look up to, you know. So really glad we could do this today. And do you guys have anything else that you guys want to say before we end today's podcast?
No, just thank you for having us. You know, I think real hustle, which is genuine, is always seen, you know. And I guess we wish you guys all the best, because whatever articles we've read on your platform have been so well-written, well-researched. Even the passion comes through, you know.
Right.
Just keep on keeping on. Thank you for having us.
Amazing, guys. Thank you so much. And looking forward to many, many more collabs, and wish you guys all the luck in the world. Thank you, guys.
Have a lovely day.
Looking forward to meeting you in person.
Absolutely. Soon. I promise.
Okay. Have a good one.
You too, guys. Bye. Okay, bye-bye.